Today we're going to talk about fine-tuning and why it's probably a waste of your time. Fine-tuning is a technique for taking an AI model and really making it your own. It's a very complex and data-intensive process, and it's all the rage right now. Everyone who starts to get into AI thinks that fine-tuning is this kind of end-all, be-all, but the reality is far from that. Many of the major AI companies are focused on fine-tuning. OpenAI has recently made fine-tuning significantly more affordable. They have an excellent series of guides about how to use some of their latest and greatest models and fine-tune them in a way that helps make them part of your own. AWS just a few days ago discussed a stack that they're developing with their infrastructure to help support developers. And they're planning this sort of entire model with the understanding that they are going to need to develop this infrastructure built around training. AWS, Microsoft, OpenAI, all these companies are not alone in thinking that this is the way forward. Many AI enthusiasts are also hearkening the call to fine-tune models. And fine-tuning itself even sounds like something that you need to do. Well, why do we want to fine-tune a model? The reality is it's because of how we interact with these AI and really the limitations that they have. When we take a general AI model, such as OpenAI or even Llama 2, and we ask it a question, it has an available sort of memory space for us to ask that question in, right? We also need memory space for it to be able to process that question and return us an answer. If that answer kind of goes beyond that space, or it needs to generate such a long answer, it'll eventually begin to lose part of the context as well. And then we have all of the sort of related information that we really want to provide for it to be able to understand what we asked. If I'm having a conversation with an AI and I reference something I just said, right, in the chat just a few messages ago, that information is relevant. Unfortunately, we've got a lot of relevant information that we really want to give the AI, and we really don't have a place to put it. And this is the context window problem when you hear about large language models struggling with their larger contexts. That's actually what this is. It's this problem where we can't actually pass enough information in. The challenge really with fine-tuning, though, is that it's difficult for us to understand how to define the data. We need to know what the model that we have today doesn't know and how to tell it more information. I could be referencing documentation that it doesn't actually know about. I could be referencing information from my company that I needed to understand. Or I actually could be having it help me generate a report, and I actually need it to be able to understand the structure of that report. So, you know, we try and define some training data or give it some examples of how it should respond. The difficulty here is really there's some pitfalls when you go through training. One of those major challenges is the challenge of overtraining. And when we think of overtraining, we can think of it kind of like you're driving a car. If the normal way that you get home from work is every day, you kind of go and you're driving down the road and you always turn off, you know, down toward wherever your home is, right? You kind of get in the habit of doing this day after day. You kind of are used to at around this time of day, we usually do the right thing that we were planning to do and we go home, right? If we kind of structure an AI model around the same way, right? We say, okay, given this problem, the outcome is usually to go home, right? The difficulty is that there might be other things that change. There might be something like really valuable that we actually want to get done at that time of day instead of going home, right? We might have some other task we'd prefer it to do. Or there might actually be a challenge with the task that we normally do. There may be a hazard or something else that the AI needs to watch out for. If we overtrain that this is always the correct path home, it's not going to be able to respond to these other stimuli as effectively. So when we think about training data and giving this training data to our model in order to be able to fine-tune it, we have to think about what is a representative set of data that would represent the world around the problem that we're trying to solve, right? The way OpenAI has kind of solved this is it took in a huge corpus of information around the entire internet, right? They took sources from forums, they took sources from articles, they took news sources and published documents. They have a corpus of information that is from many different facets, and that's what makes such a believable response. when we use a fine-tuned training set that's based on some set of answers that we know, we're somewhat limited to that set of known answers, unless we can give it a more representative understanding of what the real world looks like. We get into this problem where it goes toward the goal that we've told it exists, and it's blind to any other solution. So a path with a lot less difficulty is RAG, which is retrieval augmented generation. Effectively, we're taking that same set of related data from before and breaking it up into pieces. Now, these smaller pieces can easily fit within the available space, right? They can fit in with the answer and the question, no problem at all. And what we can do is we can search for chunks that are appropriate for answering the question that we have. If we're asking a question about a certain character from a book, we could look up sources in that book or paragraphs in that book that relate to that character, which gives us a much better probability of answering that question. The training with retrieval augmented generation is really taking your data and making it available for these sorts of tools, right? By passing in these small chunks and then sending just this set of information to an LLM or an AI, we're able to more easily manage the difficulties of this problem. Another big benefit of retrieval augmented generation is that when we develop these chunks, we can always update these chunks of documents as we want. When we're talking about something like fine-tuning, you really need to do that ahead of time. You're not able to quickly change and update the data that the AI knows. It's locked in time, similar to OpenAI. They release these new models. Those models only know a bit of history up until a certain point, and after that, they don't know anything. Your fine-tuned model will be the same. As you change data, you will need to then go back and retune it to be able to handle that situation. Security is another issue. With any of these systems, users can ask questions to pull out data from your related information, and even data about the way that you are asking the system questions and how it is answering. While these methods of how you use an LLM are going to change a lot as new models come out and as you find different ways to tune your systems, that data isn't quite as proprietary. Your actual data and how you chunk it and the way that you send that data to your clients, that may actually be something that you care about securing. Because we are sort of sending chunks of documents to specific users, we also have much stronger ability to control which documents go to what users, which means we can control how much our systems know. If you're teaching a model about a number of different things that some users should know and some others shouldn't, don't assume that that will just stay in that model. One of the things that's most exciting to me about retrieval augmented generation is that there's so many interesting capabilities of really what's possible. In one of my favorite papers discussing how you can develop these autonomous agents to live in a village together, they discussed how you can use retrieval augmented generation to develop a brain-like pattern where those characters in this simulated world perceive, plan, and reflect and act. By sort of storing details about their day, they can sort of understand how things are changing and make plans for them to be able to act accordingly. While most systems are fairly rudimentary, where we're simply dealing with data and chunking that data, there's a ton of possibilities in this space and possible ways of being able to optimize this for different situations. It's a really fascinating space, and I think it has significantly more legs than fine-tuning, which relies on you and your company and employees to be able to understand how to curate data that an AI can understand. If you've enjoyed this, please consider following us on Stable Discussion. We have a podcast and a publication where we discuss different things about AI, and we'll be posting more regularly as the weeks go on. Thanks so much.